This is Research Like a Pro, episode 170, Choosing a DNA Objective Using a Surname Search. Welcome to Research Like a Pro, a genealogy podcast about taking your research to the next level, hosted by Nicole Dyer and Diana Elder, accredited genealogy professional. Diana and Nicole are the mother-daughter team at FamilyLockit.com and the creators of the Amazon best-selling book, Research Like a Pro, a Genealogist's Guide. I'm Nicole, co-host of the podcast. Join Diana and me as we discuss how to stay organized, make progress in our research, and solve difficult cases. Let's go. Hi, everyone. Welcome to Research Like a Pro.
Hi, Nicole. How are you doing today?
I'm doing great. I've been working on writing a client report, and it's an interesting one because there are several generations. There's like three generations that I'm working on in a family. And so I'm trying to decide how to organize that. And usually I put the previously known information at the very beginning. But this time I think I might split it out into previously known information for each generation so that it flows a little better instead of having to make the reader remember back to the beginning of the report when I talked about previously known information about generation 2 and 3.
I think that's a really good idea. And that kind of points to the fact that every report is a little different depending on the project. Yes. So you adapt.
So what have you been doing?
Well, I'm working on my DNA study group project, and I'm working with the matches of one of my second cousins, twice removed, I believe. And he's two generations closer to my Cynthia Dillard. Everybody listening has heard that name a lot. And I'm trying to find her father or candidates for her father with this project. And it's pretty much coming down to pure DNA because I have done so much research in the documents. I come up with just, you know, a bunch of negatives. So I wanted to use this DNA of her great grandson. And the first thing that we do is do some initial clustering. So I just did a Leeds method for his DNA matches on Ancestry because I haven't worked with his matches before and I don't know all these different people. You know, when we work with our own DNA matches, we get to know all the different people and we recognize the names and we can just immediately go, oh, that's great grandma's family, that's great grandpa's family, and we assign them almost in our heads because we know the surnames and such. But this one I'm coming at pretty new. There's a few matches from our side that I recognize, but I wanted to do a Leeds chart just to get an idea. And of course, this is Southern ancestry, and so I have got a lot of pedigree collapse. So instead of the four nice great-grandparent lines, I have got 11. So we're seeing some intermarriage that I will sort out, or I will try to find some matches that aren't involved in that and perhaps work with them. I don't know. It was just a fun exercise to see what was going on.
Yeah. And Dana has a post on her website about that. I'll have to link to it in the show notes, but I've looked at this before. It's called Leeds Method. Why do I have more than four clusters? Or time to consolidate.
Yeah, I will definitely be working with that. And it's fun because Dana's in our study group. So I can even reach out to her and say, okay, look at this. See what you think.
Yes. Yeah, I think she just talks about overlap, a person with more than one color, heavy overlap. And she says to just combine those colors into one when you have a lot of overlap between clusters.
Oh, that makes sense. And I did notice that there were like my blue, red, and green heavy overlap. Those are obviously all one group of people coming down. But what I want to do is try to figure out where the marriage was of the related people. I'm just always curious about that to see what's happening. So I'll probably use that as some clues for a little research. And when I start diagramming out the lines, I'm sure that'll start to come clear.
Absolutely. I love the way that it helps us see everything clearly when we put it into a Lucid chart diagram or whatever kind of diagram you're making.
Yeah.
For our announcements today, we have DNA study group that begins on February 16th, 2022. We'll start registration for that in December, so you can plan ahead. Next fall, we'll do the Research Like a Pro study group without DNA. And if you would like to be a peer group leader, please think about that, and you can apply on our website. And be sure to join our newsletter, our Family Lockit newsletter that comes out every Monday. And sometimes we'll send you special newsletters on days other than Monday with coupons and deals when we have a special going on.
I'm actually pretty excited that we're going to do the DNA study group back to back, because then if I don't quite figure out my objective for this study group, I can just continue right on working with it in the spring. So that'll be great. Well, today we're going to talk a little bit about choosing a DNA objective using a surname search, which is a fun feature on the different testing websites. I wrote this blog post because I was just doing a little exploring with some of my matches and trying to think what would be some good projects to do. You know, we all have brick walls that we want to break down, but do we really have enough DNA to break down that brick wall? So there's a few things that you can do with the surname search to give you some ideas about choosing that objective. The example that I used in the blog post that we'll talk about is my ancestor, Mary Clemzy Klein, and she was born about 1818 in Missouri. Now, I have a hypothesis that her father is John Klein. That's who a lot of people in online trees have assigned as her father. And so she would be a great candidate for DNA because I have traced her back to Missouri and I found a possible brother in a Jacob Klein, but you know, just not a lot of documentary evidence at that time period in that place for a father. So I thought it would be fun to look on every testing website and to see what I could find with my Kleins.
Well, that's a fun idea to choose a brick wall that you have and then search for that surname. And that would work well for Klein, spelled C-L-I-N-E. But what about Smith? You know, that probably wouldn't work as well, would it?
You're right. It probably wouldn't. You could still try it, but it may not be as useful because you'd have so many different names that would come up. But Klein is a little bit more unusual. So, you know, I decided just to see what it was like on each of the different testing websites, because each of them does let you search by a surname to quickly narrow down your matches to some specific lines. So if you've never tried this before, it's fast, it's easy, and it's kind of fun. So you could pick one of your more unusual surnames, perhaps with a brick wall, or maybe you want to just do some verification. You know, you have proven through documents an ancestor, and now you would like to back it up with the DNA. So it could work for any kind of a project. So 23andMe lets you search by keyword. So it doesn't specifically say surname, but you can add a surname and a locality. Then you can also filter by either mom or dad's side to narrow down your DNA matches. So I like that you could put in a locality because that helps you narrow in as well. And people on 23andMe can add in localities for their family history. And sometimes you get really lucky and find something great.
Yeah, that's a really fun thing at 23andMe that you can filter by mom's side or dad's side. And that's because you've had your mom take a test there, right?
That's right. And I'm so glad you mentioned that because you suggested that. I had had her test on Ancestry and then uploaded her DNA on the other sites. But 23andMe, you have to test there. And you had suggested that I just do that because there's some great tools on 23andMe. And I'm so glad I did that because it's been really, really helpful having that bucketed to mom's side. And then if they're not on the mom's side, you know, they're on the dad's side.
Yeah. So you can just type in any kind of keyword, but it has to be something that that DNA match might have on their profile, right?
Right.
So they can put in surnames and they can put in locations, right? Is that what most people have on 23andMe?
Yes. And so when I did Klein in Missouri and I filtered it to father's side because I knew this was my father's line, there were two matches that came right up that had both Klein and Missouri in their profile page. And that was really helpful. I love it when people put something about their family tree in there because now I can contact them and have a good message saying, I see that we possibly match Klein's in Missouri and I would love to connect with you and work more on this. So I have more information when I'm giving them a message, just rather than just a random message saying, hey, we connect. Do you know how we connect?
So right.
It's better to have an idea, I think.
Yeah, it's really lucky when you can find a match from that second or third great grandparent And then you figure out how you're related, and then you can use them to sort your matches, look at their shared match list, and find more matches who likely descend from that common ancestral couple. So that's always really a piece of gold there when you can find that match at 23andMe who's from the right ancestor.
Right. Because it only takes one or two matches, and then you use their shared matching to find more people who maybe have not put in a surname or locality, but you know, you connect with them on this possible line. So
yeah. And then the tools at 23andMe are really great because you can see how much those two people share with each other. And so what I did on a project once with that is I found somebody who descended from that common ancestor, looked at the shared matches, and then looked for their closest matches, and then compared them to each other. And you can really get an idea of who everyone is a little bit faster that way.
Yes, I have used that so much, seeing how they are related to their matches. Oh, it makes a huge difference. Great point. Yeah.
So what about on Ancestry with the surname search?
Well, Ancestry has a specific surname search, so it will locate the common surname of both your tree and that of a DNA match. This weeds out those matches who don't have a tree, for one thing, which we all know there are lots and lots of people in Ancestry that don't have trees. And then you get the smaller pool of possibilities of people that just have that surname in their tree. So that is nice. And you do that easily just by clicking on search at the top of your DNA matches, and then you enter it in the field labeled surname in matches trees. And then you can look to see if it's on the correct line. If you have a common name like Smiths, you're going to get way too many. But again, if you can determine a little bit less common name that might be in someone's tree, maybe you can get a good pool of matches. So I did that. I put in Klein as a surname, and I could also put in a birth location. So I put in Missouri, and I had 9 matches. And the top match has identified John Klein as an ancestor, which is my hypothesis. So right away, quickly, I was able to find a match, and I could again look at shared matches and use that as a basis for my project.
That's awesome that you could find it right away like that. Ancestry does have the best trees of all the sites. So it's usually the go-to website that you go to first to find matches, because not only have the largest database, but they have all these great trees. So that's exciting. I have found with that surname search and the birth location search, when you put them together, that it doesn't always work like I would hope it would, which is fine. But I mean, sometimes that birth location is taken to be very broad. You know how Ancestry has those sliders?
Yeah.
It's like sometimes I can't find anybody in the matches tree that showed up in the list after I searched for that has that birth location. And I'm like, did they just ignore that? So I don't know. Maybe there's just so many people in the tree that I just didn't find that person.
Yeah, it's just a starting point, right? And then you have to keep digging.
Definitely. I think it's a good way to try and narrow things down. So that's helpful.
And I especially like that it filters out the people that don't have trees, so that you end up with a small list of people with trees. It's a time saver, and it lets you see if there's some valid DNA matches to work with. And this is a little bit further back for me. So I am working with further back cousins. Like the top match was a 4th to 6th cousin sharing 27 centimorgans. And so I'd have to really work to make sure it was sharing on this right line, and that we didn't share DNA on other lines, you know, looking at both of our trees. But at least gives me a starting point for a project and lets me know that I do have something to work with.
Absolutely. Let's talk a little bit about finding those surnames in common between you and a match. So you mentioned that earlier, but you go to that a little bit of a different way, right? So you click on your match, and then you scroll down on the match page, and it tells you the list of shared surnames between your tree and the DNA matches tree.
Right. And that's helpful.
So that's a really helpful way when you're looking at a tree to kind of figure things out, especially if Ancestry hasn't figured it out already for you. It gives you some suggestions, but oftentimes it just picks out the most common surnames. Like, look, you have 3 people with the surname Smith and 4 with the surname Miller. And then I'm looking at a match right now, and we have 7 people with the surname Dyer and 3 with the surname Arnold, but there's also some Millers and Smiths. Another thing I like to do with the surnames on the match page is click on the person and look at surnames in that person's tree only.
Yes.
you know, when you're doing pedigree triangulation and trying to figure out the common ancestor among a cluster of matches where it's an unknown cluster to you. And so you don't have those people in your tree. And so they're not going to show up in shared surnames. And hopefully they know who the ancestor is and they have it in their tree. And sometimes you can use those surnames to figure it out. But often they'll have like 100 surnames there. So it's a lot to sort through.
Yeah, it is. And sometimes they may not know for sure the correct ancestor. They've gathered information from other trees. But if you see a surname and you're in the right county or location for the time period that you suspect is right, it lets you know you're kind of on the right track.
That's true. And another thing that I've done with Ancestry's surname search is looking for those unique surnames that some of the descendants have. You know, you're talking about finding John Klein's descendants. And if he had a daughter who married like a unique surname, like I've been searching for the surname Vandiver. And so that's one of the descendants in a DNA case I'm working on. And so all of their descendants have that name Vandiver in their tree. It's not in my tree because my person married somebody else and didn't have that same surname, but they both come from the same father, I think. So it's a helpful way to kind of narrow down people who could be descending through that line.
That's a really good suggestion, to look for a different surname that's connected. You could do that with your Smith family too. Find somebody that's a little bit more unique that married in or somehow has a connection to them.
Yeah, those daughters who got married, and especially if you're far back enough, like in the, you know, early 1800s, where a lot of people haven't been able to trace their tree back that far. If you're able to trace the hypothesized ancestor forward in time, then you all of a sudden have a bunch of surnames for your hypothesis that you can start searching for all those children, those daughters who married someone else.
Absolutely. Ancestry does give you lots of fun tools. And because it is such a large database, doing this kind of a search will help you to narrow down, because it can seem overwhelming when you look at all those results, you know, your thousands of matches. Who is the one that's going to help you?
Yeah.
So some of these searches can help a lot.
And then you can just use that match you find to help you find more matches that you can then build out their trees that are going to descend from that same side of the family.
Right.
So tell us about doing the surname search at Family Tree DNA.
Well, Family Tree DNA has a standard search for one surname and an advanced search for two surnames. So that might be helpful if you have that common name of a Smith, and then you could put in one of the less common names for the second surname, and they will generate DNA matches who either use one of the surnames or have entered either surname into their list of ancestral surnames. So again, you kind of have to understand what each website is giving you when you put that search in. And then if the match has a tree, you can quickly see if the common surname connects to your line. So you might put in a surname and then find out really it's completely unconnected. But when I did this for my Klein search, I found 4 matches on my paternal line. And because I have done the bucketing on Family Tree DNA, which means Family Tree DNA knows which ones are my maternal matches and which ones are my paternal matches, I could, you know, really quickly say, okay, I've got 4 matches on my paternal line. And then I could look at our in common with matches, and I found several more that I could then use.
That's great. I'll put a link in the show notes to my blog post about how to do Family Tree DNA, family matching and bucketing, because it is so useful if you've done that. Then when you do your surname search, it's like a quick verification that it's on the right side of the family, right? So you can see, oh, this person is on the mom's side, even though she has the Dyer surname. She's on the mom's side, so I know it's not right. You know, I want somebody on the father's side. So it can help you narrow those down and see if your search is yielding the right results that you want.
It's very, very helpful. And especially now where they've removed some of the really small matches, you have a little more confidence that these are viable matches.
Yes. You know, recently I saw Blaine Bettinger and Leah Larkin posting about how the new white paper from Family Tree DNA about their matching algorithm is showing even more clearly how the small segments are mostly false. And they have a really great table that was in the Family Tree DNA white paper, and it shows the percentage of false positives for one centimorgan segment, two centimorgan segments, all the way up till 14. And it's pretty amazing. You know, one centimorgan segment is 99.96% false positive. And then as you get up to like four centimorgans, it's 81% false positives. Then the more you go up, the less percent you have. So by the time you get to 10 centimorgans, it's only 2% of those are false positives. And then once you get past that, it's a pretty good bet that they're going to be true segments. You know, 12, 13, and 14 centimorgan segments are 0.5% false positives or 0.29% false positives. So it's just interesting to see on the table how many of those smaller segments were false.
I read that article and looked at that too and thought, wow, it's kind of appalling that if you're using small segments and relying on those, about how many of those are false. And I love how Blaine Bettinger calls those poisonous segments, those really small ones, because they can poison our findings, right? Yes. If we're relying on those.
Yeah, I'll put the link to that in the show notes. I'm linking to the Leah Larkin one called The Small Segment Debate is Over. And she has a screenshot of that table I was just reading from. Let's see, going back to surname searches. What about MyHeritage? Oh, wait, did you tell us what you found at FamilyTree with clients?
I found four matches that specifically had Klein. And then they have shared matching. The one thing we didn't mention that's kind of fun with FamilyTree DNA is that when you are on the match page, it will have the list of their ancestral surnames right there. So you can look through it really quickly. And, you know, you can see if they have a tree. They just give you so much information now on their new matching page, which I really like.
The match list, it loads faster. And you can have a little higher confidence that your matches are actually sharing the amount that it says they're sharing.
Makes me want to use it more. It's great.
All right, let's go on to MyHeritage then.
MyHeritage will also locate DNA matches who share the surname. So it's maybe their surname, or they have it listed as an ancestral surname in their tree. And you just click their little magnifying glass icon, their search icon, to open the search window and then enter the surname and a list of matches appear. And then they can each be evaluated. So when I did that for Klein and MyHeritage, I came up with 20 matches. I found it a little bit more clunky though. And when I looked at their trees, I actually couldn't find the Kleins in them. So I was a little confused about what MyHeritage was doing with it. So I didn't dig into it anymore. But that was the one that I thought, well, I'm guessing there's a reason why these are showing up with that surname search, but it wasn't as easy for me to right away find matches that were really valid.
Yeah, that's tricky. They could be using a name that's not in their ancestors, but in their ancestors' descendants, so it wouldn't appear in the pedigree right away.
Right. And I think it just points out the fact that although we have the same type of searches on each website, each one is using a whole different algorithm for how they're doing their searching, and people have put different things into each website. So you use it as a starting point, which is why I love doing a whole project. So if I were to do this project, which is on my list, I would use this tool to go find some relevant matches from each one of the websites, then dive more into exploring those matches, but it gives you a good starting point.
For sure. Yeah, I was just testing that out at MyHeritage with your matches, and I noticed that all the people who are returning as a Klein match, you know, when I search for that surname, they have a lot of people in their tree, like over 500 or over 1,000. So they probably just have a random person in their tree with Klein.
Yeah. And the first one that comes up is my first cousin on my mom's side.
Yeah.
Which is not helpful because that's the wrong side. So I just wasn't as excited about my results there. But that doesn't mean I couldn't use that. I just would have to do more digging and do a really focused look at these matches.
Yeah, that's true. The one great feature about MyHeritage trees, which is similar to other trees like Ancestry, is that once you click on the link to view the person's tree, then there's a search bar in the top right called Find a Person. So you can just type in your surname again there and it will bring up all the people with that surname. And one of these matches I'm looking at does have Mary Clumsy Klein in their tree. So,
Oh, great.
I'll tell you the name later.
So yeah, it's just a matter of sorting through them. And of course, if I were doing this project, I would be using our Airtable research log to be recording the matches that were relevant, so I wouldn't lose them again. Because sometimes when you're doing things like this, you get lost in the weeds of all the different results. And then you go back and you think, well, wait, who was that match? And that's so disappointing when it's hard to find them again.
It is. It's good to keep track of the ones you look at, especially when you find that they're related on that side of the family you want to work on.
Right. You know, even if you just wanted to do some preliminary work, I would definitely recommend starting an Airtable research log and naming your objective. You know, my objective would be to find the father of Mary Clumsy Klein, born 1818 in Missouri. And then I could do some work searching for some good DNA matches on each website and get those entered into Airtable so that I wouldn't be redoing that again and again. Just have them there waiting for me when I wanted to start working on that project.
Absolutely. I'm going to put a link to my latest Airtable DNA research log base in the show notes. I'm always making new ones because I find something that I want to do a little differently. So this one's called RLP with DNA 2021 research log. Check it out.
It's great. I just started a new project yesterday and started entering in using the new log. And I really like the changes you've made. I agree. Sometimes it just takes us experimenting and working through these projects to realize we would like to have a little different feature, or we could maybe combine two things. I love it. The basics are the same. So if you've been using Airtable for DNA, it's not like huge changes, but little things, little tweaks Nicole's made that I think are great.
Yeah. I mean, I used to have two research logs in the Airtable base, one for DNA and one for traditional. But I finally just realized I need to have it all in one. And then I had a table for DNA test takers and then a table for DNA matches. And I was like, why don't I just have one table for all the people that might be part of this project? And some of them might not be DNA testers or matches. They might just be a relative that I'm corresponding with or someone I'm asking to take a test, or even the research subject, the ancestor that I'm focusing on. I might want to have them in my people tab. You know, I learned a lot from last year's study group and the one before that, just by seeing what other people put in their research log. And there was one study group member who put a table just for most recent common ancestral couples so that he could link to those. And that was kind of fun to see how he did that. So everybody does things just a little different, and it's fun to learn from each other.
Well, and the nice thing is once you have your basic log in place, you know, you can add to it with what your specific project needs. I know I have one client project that we're going generation by generation back through the tree, verifying and doing additional research. And I just decided to put it all in one log. And I have first generation for one page, you know, with the records. And then I have the second generation, and I start breaking it out, second generation and this set of grandparents and this set. But it's been really nice because a lot of times those records connect. You know, you've got the child in one, and then you've got them as a parent in another one, and you can copy and paste records and everything's all together. So I experimented with that and thought, well, how do I want to do this? And so far it's been working really well. So if you want to just verify your generations, that might be a fun idea to do.
Oh, great idea.
Well, we've had some fun talking about DNA like we always do. I hope everyone listening can go try out the surname search. Maybe you've used this a lot, but you haven't tried it on all the different websites. So pick an uncommon surname and go see what you can find and see if maybe you get some ideas for a good DNA objective for a research project.
All right. Thanks, everybody. We'll talk to you guys again next week.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you for listening. We hope that something you heard today will help you make progress in your research. If you want to learn more, purchase our book, Research Like a Pro, A Genealogist's Guide, on Amazon.com and other booksellers. You can also register for our Research Like a Pro online course or join our next study group. Learn more at familylockit.com. To share your progress and ask questions, join our private Facebook group by sending us your book receipt or joining our e-course or study group. If you like what you heard and would like to support this podcast, please subscribe, rate, and review. We hope you'll start now to research like a pro.